So it's nice to be here, my first time, and nice to meet you all. Today I'm going to kind of reiterate my talk, mainly from the last time we see. So whoever was there and saw it would not find too much new stuff. Some things have happened. So the first paper, which was in submission state, now is accepted to AAAAI. So its presentation has obviously improved. But other than that, it's more or less the same content, a little bit longer because Peter he scared me. He said that you like to meet for 2 hours straight and ask huge amount of questions. So there are like 45 or something slides in this talk, and you are welcome to to ask questions in the middle, and let's see how it goes.
Just a remark here. I said 45 minutes talk usually is an hour and a half because people have interesting questions. Whoever here is afraid of 2 hours, hopefully we won't reach 2 hours today. We'll see.
I see. So it was just for me. You didn't care.
No, it was because just when we were talking before that, there was some very long, interesting, but very long lecture. And maybe I was also afraid of it. I don't know. Maybe it's that thing.
Let's see
what's going on. Yeah,
let's see how it goes. So let's start with some question from me to you, the audience. So obviously we all come from different backgrounds, so for you, what is future learning for you? So I don't know, you can say if you like, or I can have a conjecture of some of what some of you may think. So I guess I'll do that. So, who thinks future learning is about training big, deep models with few examples? It sounds relevant, right? Like maybe it is this. Well, it's not. Let's see somebody who tried it. So here is an illustration. You have your, few shot model. Here's a training process optimizer, right? That's a single example. And obviously it overfitted, right? Overfitted, that's not what we want. So, actually future learning is a little bit more prosaic. So it's about training a model in such a way so it can adapt to new classes with few examples. And adapt is a key word here, right? So what does it mean to adapt? It means that, you basically train a lot of data. It's not just not the target data you want, right? It's a lot of... A question? Okay.
Let me see. Maybe somebody's not on mute. I will put them for us.
Okay. No problem. Doesn't bother me. Just if you have questions, do ask. So basically, you do pre-train a huge amount of data for some classes, but these are not the classes you want. These are the what is called the base classes, and there are lots of useful, even I would say commercial applications, for this kind of setting. But basically it boils down to cases where you cannot pre-train for all you want in advance. When it happens, for instance, in logos, right? You can pre-train on some logos, but naturally, there are thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands different logos and different flavors of logos, they're changing all the time with seasons, with places, and so on. You cannot pre-train for all of them in advance. You do pre-train on some. But then you need instant support to new types, right? And future learning can give it to you. By the way, all the nice images I'm showing you, that there are some things from our past projects. We actually had a project on logo detection with just one example. So you could actually give it just one example and do nice work on detecting similar logos in data. So another nice application is food, right? So food, like logos, infinite possibilities. And if you would like, for instance, to have a self-checkout, automatic checkout in restaurants, and this is actually a very nice project we did with one of our few shot models for few shot detection from CVPL last year. Obviously in each restaurant you get, its own food. Every day it's different. The menu cycle in catering restaurants, this was catering restaurants, it's like, I don't know, a few months. So, and every day you get something else and infinite possibilities. Every cook does it differently. So here, for instance, The idea was to train in the morning just with one example or three examples per dish, and then, you know, detect them in arbitrary positions, and they could be just part of the plate, not the entire plate, and so on. Retail products, natural extension, industrial applications. So I'm trying to convince you here that it's something that's very, very practical. You do pre-train on some data, but then you need to adapt to new data with very, very little, you know, amount of examples. So after this introduction, that's basically the breakdown of today's talk. I'll mention three papers, you know, two of those are from ECCV, well, now I can say last year. Previously it was CVPR 2 years because it was 19. We changed the year recently. So this is from ECCV 20. This one will appear in February on AAAI, and we'll start with this one. So without further ado, the first paper is called StarNet Towards Weakly Supervised Fish-Out Object Detection. Here's a link to the paper, nice list of authors. Here you see some pictures of them. Great guys, great team, and I think very nice work. So let's start from a bit of afar, right? So let's start with some motivation. I'm you know, I'm jumping ahead. I want to give a motivation to weakly supervised in the name. So bear with me for a little bit. So how do you obtain a few shot model? So we said about adapting, right? So first, you do need to collect a lot of data for the base classes, okay? So the base classes are, like I said, you know, lots of data, lots of classes. Actually, it was found many, many times, and I have a lot of evidence for that. The more classes you have, it's even more important than having a lot of data. So you want to have really a lot of classes and lots of data for lots of classes. That's the best combination. But lots of classes is more important. To collect that, and using this, you pre-train your model. But to collect that, obviously, you need to invest, right? You need to, you know, collect all these images. You need to annotate all these images, right? And after you have collected and annotated, by annotating, you know, for detection, it's bounding boxes. For segmentation, it's label instance masks, so it's expensive. After you collected everything, you train your model. That's your base model. Having your base model, now you can adapt it to, you know, and you train it in a special way, you know, best for few shot. We'll discuss some methods, and here's one in this paper. The adaptation phase is cheap, right? Because for adaptation phase, you only need a little data and a little bit of annotation. Okay, maybe no annotation. In this paper, actually don't need it. But obviously, you know, this could be even done by one person. And you have your few-shot model that you wanted. And this model can recognize or detect, you know, new classes that weren't in the base training data. So completely new classes from really few examples, but in adaptation mode, not in, you know, full training mode from scratch. So having this long introduction, why the weak supervision, right? So weak supervision, you know, whoever is not familiar with the term, that's kind of, you know, supervision lacking some details. For instance, you want to do detection, give me supervision which are just image labels, right? That's weak supervision. That's an example. Okay, so why do we need weak supervision for a few shot? Because, you know, like you said, adaptation is cheap, but the base training is not. And that's another fact, and there are some references, including our own, that show that, but few shot methods are actually very bad under domain shift. So basically, if you pre-train, let's say these are your base classes, ImageNet, right? Everybody knows ImageNet. But then you want to adapt to new kind of classes, you know, which are different modality, different imagery type, not perspective, maybe aerial, maybe even X-ray, right? Or maybe, you know, something like skin lesions and so on. This wouldn't work well. And by the end of the talk, when I cover the third paper, you'll see, you know, what's the size of the hole? And another example is very different classes. So when people talk about cross domain, many times actually refer to this part, like we'll see, you know, like going from ImageNet to types of birds, but it's really both, right? completely different classes or completely different imagery. In both cases, few shot methods will fail. And the only way to recover is actually go back, you know, and collect the big data for your domain, many classes, as many as you can, because that's the most important factor, and lots of data, and annotate it, right, for your task. If it's detection, then, you know, bounding boxes or masks or whatever. So again, expensive adaptation to new domains with few shot methods. After you adapt, right, after you create your base model for the new domain, you can, you know, invest little money to add more target classes. That's fine. But the first phase is expensive. And like I said, detection, you know, even more expensive because of the bounding boxes and so on. So maybe classification, we can collect, just label some images with a tag, right? Tag some images. But for bounding boxes, we really need to work. And if you go segmentation, it's even more work. So I hope I convinced you that we actually do need weak supervision. So basically, you know, reducing the cost of annotation. For example, here we'll focus on detection. So for detection, we want to reduce the bounding boxes, basically. And if we do that, we reduce the cost of adapting to new domains.
So there's a question in the chat. What's the reason for the bad in like the adaptation problem in different domains, in between different domains?
Well, it's pretty intuitive. I'll talk a little more about that when we talk about the second paper, but basically the features are bad. So when you train your model to distinguish between these type of classes, the model actually kind of, you know, finds the best features to do that, right? It has a certain capacity, right? So a certain number of parameters that are invested, and there are all sorts of, you know, robustness, like to drop out, to different things, you know, we do for the model, and everything, you know, tasks on the capacity, eats out the capacity, and the model tries to do its best, and you know, after it did its best, it tries to do even better, and that's overfitting, basically, right? It tries to do even better, and eventually you end up with things which really good, you know, some detect. So what are features in your feature vector, right? That kind of a detectors of some unnamed concepts, right? Like you know, if you go to every feature and start collecting, and people did that, right? Like many works did that. You start collecting images which activate this feature more, you'll see some nice patterns, right? This feature is for animal heads. This feature is for church chimneys, whatever. Okay, of course, they're not like that. They're kind of a mix, but never mind. I mean, they all have certain patterns they detect. And these patterns are good for your base classes. If these patterns are useless for your target classes, I mean, useless or let's say, oh, I'm jumping ahead, that's the second paper. But they are somewhat useful, but many, many things are not useful, right? So you are drowning in noise, okay? That's the second paper, forget I said it. Okay, so I hope it's intuitive. I mean, it's pretty intuitive, right? Like you train on something, you know, unrelated tasks, you get unrelated results. Okay, so going back, StyleNet can actually, you know, reduce the supervision cost because it can, you know, it can train with weak supervision. Basically, you can give it any classification training, you know, base training, and even, you know, the new classes, they can come with just image tags, and it, you know, it learns to detect objects. Okay, because I'm jumping, so it's in the next slide. Sorry, what did I do? I'm running backwards. Okay, because it actually classifies through detection. It, you know, it does some matching of objects, and that's how it knows these images are the same label. But I'm jumping ahead. We'll see it immediately in a couple of slides. Okay, So we said StyleNet can do weak supervision, and we said it's very important for few shot because of the domain shift, you know, in terms of the application. But there is another benefit, right? So basically, it trains on classification data. So basically, it's a classifier, right? So you can think of it as a classifier. Okay, also, you know, does some localization. We'll talk about it, but it's a classifier. So you know, being a classifier, We can think of its ability to localize as kind of a way of explaining decisions, explaining predictions. And in some cases, it's very important. So this is, of course, a toy example, right? It's not like always you get multi-label images, but let's say you did, right? So let's say, you know, these, and that's actually a live experiment here. So let's say your support classes, basically the target classes, another name for them in future literature is support classes, right? The classes you want to learn to adapt to them with few examples are called support, okay, target classes. So let's say these support classes are parrot, turtle, dog, and chicken, right? And you have these queries, and naturally there is no right answer, right? But what the model does, it actually, you know, it gives you some answer. So it says turtle and parrot, but it also, you know, it kind of explains why, because, you know, you give it this image, you don't give it any location, just say that's a turtle or that's a parrot, that's a dog, that's a chicken. But it learns to, you know, to match. So it basically, it matched, it says, okay, I think this image, query image is a turtle, right? Because I found this match, okay? And I think that's a parrot because I found this match. And it communicates through heat maps. We'll get back to that in the next slide. So why is it useful? So first of all, you know, it kind of explains its decision. It's abused word, I know, but I think it's a nice capability. And second, you know, it's very useful for debugging. What I mean debugging, let's say, you know, you're learning your whatever future classifier, right? It starts giving you some answers. You want to understand why did it do that? So if you see it matches the right objects, you are gaining confidence in it, right? And if you see it matches the, you know, top left of your image, because there is some text in medical images, there's always a text with a diagnosis there, right? And then, okay, I think these two things match because the diagnosis is the same. That's not good, okay? Something bad happening. So I'm kind of trying to convince you, you know, this ability to explain through localization is also good for many things, and building confidence and debugging is one of them. Okay, so after this very long introduction, a short recap on the task we are trying to solve in this paper. That's called weakly supervised visual detection. To the best of my knowledge, we are the first to approach this task, right? Nobody tried it before. Visual detection, there were papers on that, but all of them pre-trained using bounding boxes and then used bounding boxes for adaptation. In our case, we pre-train with just the image tags, okay, like a classifier. And we adapt to new classes also with tags. So no bounding boxes are observed by the model at any stage, but it learns to output heat maps. And of course, you know, from a heat map, it is a simple way, you know, establishing in different weakly supervised works without the few shot component. And we use the same method. So out of a heat map, you can get a bounding box. Here are some examples of detection the model does. And let's dive in. So I'll use this complex diagram we have in the paper. So all the details, I think, are explained pretty, you know, simply in the paper. So I urge you to try and read, you know, the method section to understand what I'm trying to explain here. You know, there it's given in mathematical terms. Here I'll do it in more hand-wavy, illustrative fashion. But I think you know, some of you that are familiar with half-transforms and so on, I think it will find it also pretty understandable. So like I said, the model learns the best features for matching objects, okay? It starts from random, but gradually it learns these features to match. And here I'll explain how it does that. So how it actually matches and what is the loss and what's the entire process. So obviously we work on batches, but for simplicity, I'll just illustrate it on one pair, right? Query and support, okay? And for this sake of illustration, let's assume that they share an object. Obviously the same construction works when they don't share an object and then the score is low. But here I'm just interested to illustrate, you know, the high score part. Okay, so these two images, they enter the Fourier convolutional. Back with Fourier convolution, I mean, there are only convolution operations. So basically you enter an image, output a feature grid, a feature map, or whatever you like to call it, right? It's a tensor, it has a width and a height, and then it has the channel size, okay? So like I said, it's just one image, query, one image support. So each of them gives you a 3D tensor, right? Like width, height, and channels. Okay, so you have these two feature grids. What you do then, you do a generalized half transform. Basically, we want to find, you know, a region corresponding between the support and the query, right? So to characterize the region, you know, at this stage, if you are getting disappointed because you know half transforms like that are only, you know, working for rigid same scale objects, don't be. We have some process to solve it later in this diagram. So for the beginning, we do this generalized half transform. Basically, we define an arbitrary reference point on the support. Okay, doesn't have to be in the object; it can be anywhere. We choose the center of the image. Okay, I'll explain immediately why it's not important where the reference point is. Okay, so after having this, we have this vote vector, right, for every point on the support feature grid, you know, to this reference point. Now we do dense matching, right? You do dense matching, so everything to everything. That's potentially computationally heavy operation, but these are not so big maps, right? Because we have all these strides and so on. Let's say they're 10 by 10 or 20 by 20. Not so big, right? Not in a high resolution. We actually, after the matching, I'm showing only the strongest, okay, votes, just for the illustration. And you can, I think you will agree with me that like anyone who knows generalized transform, right? So basically, if there are some good matches, they will come close with their votes. It could be outside the image, doesn't matter, but they'll agree. Okay, and this agreement will be expressed in a peak in a voting map, okay, the posterior of the half transform. Let me briefly recap, right? Single query, single support, enter fully convolutional backbone, out two feature grids, into the generalized half transform, you know, as arbitrary reference point, copied to the query.
So if you could explain this again, because this was hard to understand without this image that we're seeing now. If you could really from the beginning, I'm sorry for like you're having to explain again, but it's okay, important.
I'll do it just quickly. So everyone who are familiar with half transforms, right? You have some hypothesis, right? It's parameterized by few parameters. In this case, just a X and Y location, okay? And every, you know, match, in this case, we do dense matching. So every feature to every feature on these two grids, right, if you just flatten, right, the entire matrix, just the C dimension and multiply, you'll get dense matching, right? You'll get, you know, cosine similarity with everything. If your vectors are normalized, you'll actually get the L2 distance, right? Well, up to constant, right? So you do dense matching, you can do it very efficiently. It's just matrix multiplication. In batches, it's a little bit more tricky, but you know, PyTorch is your friend. After the dense matching, you can have a vote, right? Every feature location on the query will give you a vote of the size of the support image, right? And it will shift basically on the image, and you have a consensus, hopefully, where there are the most matches, right? And why consensus? Because you know, if these things match this thing and this thing match this thing, they agree. Oh, roughly agree up to small pose deformations. Obviously, this is, you know, this is tolerant to shift, arbitrary translation. It's not tolerant to scale. It's not tolerant to significant pose changes, but we'll handle it by the end of the diagram. So the handling will follow. Okay, currently just assume that just captures, you know, similar things up to translation. That's all. And I hope you agree that if it's just up to translation, it will find it, okay? If the features are good, right? In the beginning, they are not. But as the thing develops, and I'll show nice illustrations, you know, how it develops with time and training, like a video. I have nice videos to show that. So basically that's this part. And now just to close, you know, the first stage of the method, just taking a maximum on this voting map, you can compute the softmax coarse entropy loss with your class label, right? Assuming that you have in training just a single shot, single example per class, matching with its support produces a score. This score enters a vector, right? And matching with each support gives you a score, right? And you get this, you know, this vector of scores, which you can do the usual thing, right? Cross entropy softmax, softmax cross entropy. Okay, so that closes stage one. Now for the more interesting part, the stage two and the localization. So basically, I said this reference point could be arbitrary. Why arbitrary? Because we don't care about it. After we found, you know, the hypothesis, and we allow it to vote outside the image, everything that's okay, that's handled in the code. After we found the hypothesis, we can what's called back projected, right, to the original evidence, right? So these matches are evidence, right? So we can ask which, you know, matches out of the dense matches agreed with the max hypothesis, okay? And then arguably, all these guys will fall down because they are not agreeing with this point, but those guys would remain, okay? And you can ask it symmetrically on both the query and the support. So actually, you know, when you multiply, you the dense matching from query to support, from support to query, is just the same, right? It's symmetrical, right? So basically, after the back projection, you do it twice, once for query, once for the support, you start getting some heat maps, okay? Maybe not the thing you want itself, but some beginning of it. Right, and just, you know, to complete the cycle, and I'll immediately go back to how do you grow them, but to complete the cycle, if you have these heat maps, okay, I guess it's my side. So after you have these heat maps, you can have what's called a stage two. If you're familiar with faster CNN, it's just like in faster CNN, you have these attention maps, apply the attention, get the feature vector, you know, classify it. Here we use some variant of prototypical network, but it's attended by the found matches. And what's different from the standard prototypical network here, for every pair of supported query, you actually get different feature vectors, right? So it's adapting to the matches, right? You know, it finds matches between every pair of images. So everything is nice up to the fact that you probably are complaining, or you are thinking about this translation, you know, restriction.